Thank you, Ilias and Algira, for organizing what I'm sure will be one more amazing Echo Weekend, for inviting me here. So I'm going to talk. So I'm going to bring the landscape approach. I'll make a brief introduction about who we are, why we do what we do, and why I think what you're doing is extremely important. And then I'll kind of give you some principles that are important in landscape ecology, and show you some work that for me is characteristic. It's mainly our work, and it sort of shows who we are and what we do. So who we are is a group of 12 professionals, architects and landscape architects. I myself started out as an architect training in the US. And while training as an architect, I saw people in the same architecture school doing something that to me seemed extremely interesting. And I checked it out and I found out about landscape architecture, and since it's been my main passion. So we're a group of people that looks relatively normal on the outside, but in fact, this is who we are on the inside. And this is the kind of drive that we have. And I assume that everyone in this room, or most people in this room, have this kind of need inside them that brings them to the table. For me, it's extremely important to be having an Echo Week in Pristina. I think that what is happening here is very significant for the following reason. When we were growing up, architecture was very much based on certain key areas, let's say London, New York, and the Netherlands were the center, and to a great degree they still are. And if Athens is the periphery, allow me to say that Pristina is even more the periphery. So what are we doing here? Are we looking at what some other people are doing to learn lessons? What I see happening, and I find extremely significant, is that architecture is changing, or architecture should change, from being something which is very focused on a few bright examples to something that is happening on the ground everywhere. The only way to make the planet green is not through a few key green buildings, but through greening architecture, urban design, and our everyday life everywhere. In that sense, the periphery, I think, is where it's really going to happen. There are always going to be some bright architects somewhere in the world doing their thing. But it's only when the periphery, when we get local, when we take the principles and certain ideas, we bring them into our own life. And as Ilias was saying, we look very carefully about what is happening around us in our area. And we apply these to make great new design, that things are really going to change. So I'm going to show such examples from Greece, and I'll be very excited in a few years to see similar examples from Kosovo. So starting with a few very boring definitions. But definitions are boring, it's a good way to put people to sleep, but there's also meaning and significance, so let's start with them. So what the Council of Europe says is that landscape is an area as perceived by people, so it's the way we see something, whose character is the result of the action and interaction of natural and or human factors. And that's where it's extremely crucial, because landscape is the place where humanity and nature come together. Okay? So it teaches us certain things about how these two systems can coexist. There are some definitions that I consider a bit more inclusive, not focusing only on the visual, but on the total, which is that for me, landscape is an area whose character is the result of the action and interaction of natural and human factors. And at the end, landscape is the territorial manifestation of natural and cultural dynamics. So what we see in the end in the landscape, it's an image, but the image is the result of all the things that nature and humanity is doing and the way these two are interacting. Now, how about sustainability in the landscape? What are sustainable landscapes? Wikipedia has, again, this relatively boring definition that the biosphere, the biospheric environment, is the symbiosis, the living together between the physical environment and the biological life forms within the environment, and includes all variables that comprise the Earth's biosphere. So that means all of us. It means the people, the plants, the animals, the water cycle, everything is part of the biosphere, which is great. I mean, we're all in this together, right? But then Wikipedia goes on to say that the biophysical environment can be divided into two categories. The natural environment on the one hand, and the built environment on the other, with some overlap between the two. And that is a definition I thoroughly disagree with. This old way of thinking where there's man and what man produces on the one hand, and nature on the other, and there's a bit of sort of overlap, for me is, I won't use a nasty word, but it's it doesn't hold water. You know, is this natural or built? Or is this nature or man? Or natural or man-made? It's clear to me that everything is interactive. What we do and what nature does is a constant interaction, and it is our role to understand how that happens and to work with it. Now, how do you make a new landscape sustainable? The first lesson that I've learned is find out where you are. Don't come in with some general notions, but really, really find out where you are. Look around you. This is a beautiful picture of Kosovo, so I hope you can recognize it. Look down, look at the very small things, be very sensitive. And think hard. Preserve or change? That is a very first question, I think, that every architect, whether it's building, landscape, urban, whatever, the very first question we have to ask. Preserve or change? Now, there's a principle in landscape ecology which is called minimizing disturbance. And I will go a bit into some rules that maybe would be helpful for you. If you miss the details, don't worry, keep the general picture. If you can keep the details, they're also interesting because they apply to urban design as well, as far as I'm concerned. So some basic landscape ecology principles. Landscape ecology is the science that tries to explain or explains the geographic functioning of environmental factors. So, you know, things are happening in the environment, but these things have a physical and geographic parameter, and this is what landscape ecology studies. The basic unit of landscape ecology is the patch. Okay, the patch means a small space or a small thing, and the patch is the minimum area of habitation of a certain species. So let's say if you have a small patch of grass, then for that grass, that is the patch. For a polar bear, something else is the patch, and obviously not this small thing, but something has to be significantly larger. Patches have various characteristics. They have size, shape, distribution, etc. And these characteristics are very important for the organisms that live in the patches. For example, if your patch, if you're a boy bear, and there's another patch over there with a girl bear, it's important if you can get from one patch to the other. It's important if in the next patch you can make a nest, etc. So the characteristics of the patches are very important. Another very important fundamental sort of component is the corridor. The corridor is what organisms use to get from one place to the other. And the way most organisms work is they don't stay in one place, they move around. Even some plants do that. Animals certainly do, and they live various important parts of their lives in different locations. So they get born in one location, they grow up in another location, they find food in a different location, they find water in yet a different location, they find their girlfriend or their boyfriend in a different location. And if you, by doing whatever things, like building a highway or building a house or whatever, if you cut the corridors, what you're in fact doing is you make it impossible or very difficult for these creatures to live part of their life. So imagine someone comes and says, no, you will continue your life as normal, but you will no longer have access to water. You know, that doesn't work. So we have to be quite careful when we do things about how we're influencing the corridors. And again, the corridors have various characteristics, how wide they are, how narrow, how broken up. For example, again, if I'm here and there's a small river with stones, and there's the other side of the river over there, if I'm a bear, some nice big stones can be a corridor and I can jump across. If I'm an ant, they're not a corridor. So these things change depending on what your perspective is. And again, this also, as far as I'm concerned, applies to looking at cities, because cities, you know, urban design cannot assume the ideal city inhabitant. Different inhabitants have different needs. So when you design things in the city, you have to make sure to accommodate the various needs of the various inhabitants. Another important factor is the edge and the boundary, meaning how thick or thin a boundary is, if it's straight or convoluted. For example, usually very straight boundaries are excellent for moving along the boundary, but they're difficult to get through, and very convoluted boundaries usually promote a lot of movement through the boundary that make moving along the boundary more difficult. What's missing is an intermediate level at which these things organize into various patterns and patches, and these all come together to form what is called in landscape ecology the matrix. So the matrix is the combination of all these things in space and the way they interact. So basic principles of ecology and of landscape ecology. You have to preserve total biodiversity. You're not supposed to do things that decreases the amount of living organisms and the amount of different living organisms around. You have to preserve or enhance connectivity, because one of the main things that makes things work in the landscape, as it does in the city, is being able to get from one place to the other. Work with what you have, and as much as possible work with natural processes. It's a kind of minimizing resources, maximizing output, and it's a kind of a recycling principle. The things you have to work with are the soil, the water, and all the results that it brings into the landscape. And from what I read, Pristina is, or has had in the past, a water shortage. So water is an extremely important part of our lives and the lives of landscapes. Vegetation dynamics, because vegetation is not a static thing. Vegetation moves through time, and it changes through time. So you have to be aware, when you do something, that it is not... one of the main things that woke me up as a landscape architect is, as an architect, I was always thinking of a final result. In the landscape, you never have a final result. You create the beginning of a process, and natural processes, human processes, and time will take over, and then they will create a lot of things. So this kind of dynamics is what you have to be aware of. The fact that things can be disturbed and come back, the fact that nature can revegetate, nature can renaturalize things on its own, or if we give it a bit of a foothold. And the idea that at any scale, landscapes are dynamic systems, not static. And that landscape elements are not solo, they're always part of a whole, of a community. Again, the same for humans. So after these very general principles, and I'm open to any questions or, you know, further elaborations for whoever's interested, I will show you certain projects, some of ours and some that are not ours, where we put these principles to use in design. One of the earliest works we did when I came back from the States, and which has received the most recognition, is what we call antiparosymbiosis, and it is about going to a very beautiful and pristine island in the Aegean and doing a tourist development. So when a friend of mine came about 10 years ago and he said, you know, we're going to come to this place and we're going to build villas and roads and tennis courts and this and that, I said, but, you know, I had a very nasty feeling, how can we do this and preserve the beauty and the ecology of the place? And I explained to him that what he will in fact be selling here is not a square meter of real estate anywhere, it's a square meter of real estate in this place, and that people who are coming here are coming to be in this place. So I kind of slowly got him into the idea of preserving the place as much as possible and making it in fact the stamp of his development. And what is happening here, or what was happening at the time, is that when people wanted to make something local, they bought plants that belonged sort of to the more or less, this is the Mediterranean, so they got what are called Mediterranean plants, they put them in the garden, they watered them, and then you create a kind of fake Mediterranean, but in fact, the real Mediterranean landscape, as any real landscape, changes all the time. And it is about natural cycles, so if you don't, if you freeze it into a garden, you've lost it. So we had to deal with two very different scales of problems here. One is how to inhabit a site where everything is visible, because these sites are very steep, there's very little vegetation, so every single house, wall, car, road, etc. is immediately visible. How do you inhabit them in a way where the old and the new can create sort of a good combination, let's call it beautiful. And at that scale, we worked closely with the architects at the time to develop a master plan that was based on the characteristics of the site. So we found out that there was the topography of the hills that you see and the ravines bringing down the water. There were the historical landscape marks of human cultivation, which are these horizontal terraces and the stone retaining walls. There were areas where water and earth collects, and that's where people used to plant their tomatoes and the crops that require more water and earth, than areas which are a bit more protected and where they used to have wheat and barley, etc., and areas which are completely unprotected because the main problem here is the wind, and there they used to have goats, so there was a system, an agricultural system that ordered the landscape, and we found out all of those things, and then we created a strategy which says that we are retaining the old skeleton, we are restoring it, expanding it in certain locations, and any new element that goes on the site has to go on this skeleton. And we also made a set of rules for the architects, which is that the lower you are in the site, which is more protected, the houses can expand and become sort of part of this horizontal landscape of agricultural terraces. And when you go further up into the site, the buildings become very enclosed and protected, like you would have an old little fort or a monastery. So everything follows the rules, and this is the result. This is the expansion, restoration and expansion of the old skeleton. The areas which were destroyed during the construction of the houses, because we as architects very often assume that a beautiful building will fall from the sky in a helicopter and will not touch the landscape around it. But even a very well-designed building during construction will destroy a lot of what is there right now. So you have to be able to have a system to restore. And this is the result after the restoration. And the success for our office is the degree to which you don't see what we have done. Okay? This is visual, but it's still important. And I remember when I first showed this project to my father, he looked at it and said, what have you done here? He said, fantastic, you know, success. So the second layer has to do not so much with the look of the overall look, but what you do with the vegetation dynamics. And there's extremely beautiful, very stark vegetation on this site. And we looked at these forms and we said, you know, what's making this beauty and how can we copy it? And what we found out is that these particular plants, which are the local plants, you cannot buy in a nursery. So you want to make an ecological project, but the plants that you need to make the ecological project are not available. So we had two strategies. One strategy was for the medium and long term, we started working with small nurseries in Greece to produce these plants. And the second strategy was more immediate, and I will show you what that was. So we looked at these dynamics and we realized that they're actually not chaotic, but what you have is a limited palette of plants, and in certain cases plant A is dominant, you know, the plant that looks bluer is dominant, and the green plant is subordinate. in one area, and right next door the green plant is dominant and the blue plant is subordinate, and you have this constant movement through the landscape, because what the plants are doing is they are competing with each other, and in certain cases one wins and in other cases the other wins, but at the same time they're helping each other, they're protecting each other from the wind, they're creating more nutritious soil, etc. So there's this game happening in nature. And we developed a new type of planting, which instead of having groups of plants, okay, this could be very boring for architecture, I'll still go for it. I see three yawns, four yawns, but I'll keep going. Instead of having one big group of plants, we have the same plants, but from group to group, we change, we play with statistics. So we change the ratios of the plants. And then we were left with the problem, okay, it'll look right, but the natural landscape goes through the cycles of wet, dry, wet, dry, wet, dry. And we told the client, we let it go completely natural, it'll go wet, dry, wet, dry. And he said, no, you can't do that, because in August is where my clients are coming and I need to sell the houses and it needs to be green. And we said, well, it can't be green because this beautiful landscape is brown in the summer. And he said, no, 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 green. So we said, okay, we'll make a deal with you. Right next to the house, where your clients will be sitting, it will be green. Out of the landscape, it will be brown. And in the space in between, we will play a kind of game. And the kind of game was that as we go out into the landscape, we increase the spaces between the plants. So natural revegetation can happen between the artificial plants. So in fact, what you get is artificial vegetation going from the house out to the landscape, natural revegetation coming from the landscape back into the house, and you create this kind of continuum and keep everything as happy as possible, which is very often the work of architects. So when you're at the houses, it's sort of very stark. We used the local stone, the local building hand, as we say, because we know probably stonemasons have a hand, a sort of very stark and limited landscape palette, and a more modern version of the traditional Aegean architecture. So this is the one end. In the other end, we did zero planting. We just did irrigating with these water cannons, and we found out that nature comes back immediately. So in the second and third year, we didn't even use the water cannons. We don't even need to irrigate. And then everything in between these two extremes, and again, the success of the project and the degree that it has received, this, for example, is a planted roof, because one of the houses is partly underground, and you let the landscape go over the one side and into the other. And I will make a very brief parenthesis. This fantastic idea of having plants grow by themselves, so that you have this joining of natural and artificial vegetation. We went back the first year, and it was happening everywhere around the project, but it was not happening where we had planted our plants, and we desperately wanted this thing to come together. So we talked with the owner, and he said, you know, he didn't know exactly what was going on. So we went back the second year, and it was the same problem. So our strategy was working everywhere except where it was important. And then we talked to the client and the gardener, and the gardener said, well, you know, these things that are coming up, these weeds, I'm pulling them all out. So our lack of communication, we thought we explained everything very clearly to the owner. And we were sort of hoping that the owner explained everything very clearly to the gardener. There was a lack of communication. So it's while in a lot of traditional building thinking, you kind of build it and then people play with the switch, I think in this new era, there has to be a lot more communication and a lot more interaction and a lot more of people being actually part of what is happening in a building or in a landscape. It's not, you know, we have to go from the period of no thinking to the period of thinking. That's the way I see it. And of course, always the favorite parts for me are the parts that nature did by herself. A second project, I will show a few projects, but ones that clearly demonstrate our thinking, is one that we have done for the Greek state. It's one of the main beaches south of Athens, which is called the Vagizan Beach. And we're calling it a didactic beach because what we're trying to do is teach people about how nature can do things. So this beach is extremely popular. You go in March, let's say in April, and it's a very beautiful landscape of fields. And you go in the end of summer, and it looks like, you know, Buffalo, or, you know, terrible things have happened here. And the truth is that there are buffalo roaming in this territory, it's the cars, and it's the people who go everywhere and don't care and destroy everything. So what we realized is that nature by itself is creating something beautiful. People come and destroy it, so our job is to stop people from destroying it. That simply. So we turned the project from a project of creation by design into a project of design, non-human presence, let's say. So it's an interesting part of the city because it's where city and landscape come together. And what we did is we took every one of the things that happened on this site, and instead of putting something new in, we organized what was already there. So the cars go everywhere, and we created a system where they will be limited to the existing parking lots. Human activity all goes on the border of the beach because it was the only place that was nice to occupy. And by giving them places that are nice to occupy everywhere else, you kind of spread them much further around. There was existing trees, but very sparse and not working very well. So we took the existing vegetation and we thickened it so that it provides a natural canopy. And instead of having roofs that are buildings, the roofs are the forest. And we also took the existing parking lot and we're turning it into an ecological parking walk, because the trees drop their leaves in winter, so you have sun when you need it. And they have leaves in the summer, so you have shade when you need it. Very simple. And then I'll show you what we're doing in the eastern part, which is the most exciting. There's something with the memory. I will open a different file. Does anyone remember which slide we were on? That's not it. Were destroyed when people turned it into a kind of a public beach. And the sand dunes can in fact be turned into fantastic shapes. So there are various things happening, including recycling existing elements. For example, there's the old national road, which is that yellow thing, which we're keeping parts of it. It wasn't yellow, it's black. We're keeping parts of it, painting it yellow, and the hardscape that you have for people to play and rest, etc., rather than being something new, is the old road cut into pieces and painted yellow. And this is the way it all comes together into the master plan. And now I will focus on the area on your right, which is the most ecological and interesting one, because as we did in Antiparos, we are creating an ecological park not by planting anything, we're planting nothing. What we are doing is fencing. So we're only using the fence to put the park. Now, the characteristic of this fence is that it is wooden poles with no wire in between. So, when the poles are very wide, in the middle of this, there is a pointer. So, this is where the cars go. So, here you have constant disturbance, as you saw previously. disturbance that wipes out all the vegetation. Then when the poles are this far from each other, the cars cannot enter, the people can enter, motorcycles can enter, bicycles can enter, and you have less disturbance with the cars, but you still have disturbance. And then when the poles get this close to each other, people can still enter with a bit of difficulty, so you have very little disturbance. And then when the poles are this close to each other, no one can enter, so you have zero disturbance. So what in fact is going to happen, and you know this because landscape ecology teaches this and the landscape works that way, is that these three different types of pole density are going to create four different levels of landscape disturbance, and by themselves they will create at least three different types of landscape revegetation. And together with if you're high or low or close to the sea or in front or behind the hill, this park is going to create a whole ecology and a whole beauty by itself. And it's going to tell people that it's not what you do, but very often it is what you don't do that matters. Now, again, a small story. Kosovo and Greece, I imagine, are quite similar. We have received, it took 5 years to receive environmental permits. And having received environmental permits, now, you know, the government is deciding and thinking and this and that. So that's why I'm showing you Photoshop rather than the actual park. And we hope that now there's a new structure in place, hopefully they will go forward. And some other areas of the park, the bioclimatic parking lot, everything including the playgrounds is landscape. And the beach is done in such a way, I don't know if you remember in the plan, the forest at the beach goes back and forth and creates pockets. So all the cafeterias, restaurants, etc. are in the pockets, so when you're walking along the beach, A, you don't see them, and B, they are protected from the sun and too much heat and too much wind in these pockets. Now, it was their parking lot and it's now our park and it's not our project. We were involved merely as volunteers. This is quite a celebrated project now in Greece because it started when the crisis started and when the sort of small revolution we had in Greece around 2008. This was the parking lot of the area where this belongs to the Chamber of Architects. So it belongs to the Association of Greek Architects. And there have been many competitions to build the building and the competition and recompetition. And in the meantime, it was a parking lot. And in the meantime, the politicians had told everyone that, you know, this in the end, this is going to become a park, a public square, because it's in an area of Athens which is very dense and there are no public spaces. So when the government got around and said, okay, and now the architects association is going to build on it, people became very angry. And they went into the space, they formed local communities of local residents and communities of architects and other designers and contractors. They tore down by themselves the fencing. They started, or we started drawing the park with chalk directly on the asphalt and then started cutting it and tearing it up. And this was the first weekend. I mean, this was really done before the police had time to come, before the government had time to react. It was really, you know, it was organized and boom, directly. You know, cut, tear up, start digging, bring in the kids, and very quickly it became a party. I mean, very quickly it became beautiful, not only because of what it was going to be, but how it was being made. And people started donating plants, and plants started to appear from various parts of Greece and being dug in, and the architects were sort of designing and building furniture. You know, no money, everyone was donating things, and it became immediately a place for kids and for communal activity. And what's happened in the meantime, it happened over 1-2 weekends. And then, so we are part of this local community. We were called together with other people. And we were given a week to design and a week to construct, including getting all the permits. Now, the difficulty here was that the ministry, the archaeologists, do not allow you to dig in order to make a park, because underground there's the archaeology. They only allow you to build up. So what we decided to do is to keep the outline of the existing houses as a base for the park. And the second thing is, even then they wouldn't allow us to dig down to plant the trees, so we created little hills, mounds for the trees. And we decided that all the material except for the plants and the planting soil was going to be recycled, was going to be the recycled material that we found on site. So these are the sketches. And then the thing actually happened. There was 3,000 euros that went to a contractor to bring some people and some trucks. But other than that, it was all local action by local people, and including Roma, who are very sort of much part of the community. So it was taking the things, cleaning them up, recycling them, starting to build them into walls. And this kind of aesthetic is also very Athenian, because Athens is a city that for more than 3,000 or 4,000 years has been constantly recycled. People took things from earlier periods and built the new thing. And you keep finding this aesthetic, so it's very much a standard in the area. And then recycling, building up the pediment, building benches for people to sit, creating the mounds, using stone that we found on site for people to sit, etc. And then there was another, the next weekend there was another community action to come in and plant. And what we were very happy about, we were very sad that we destroyed the buildings that had the beautiful graffiti. But then we found out that the graffiti artist came immediately and did fantastic graffiti on the walls that were exposed. So it became very much, again, part of the local community. Community planting. Great. It looks a bit architectural, and people start to occupy it. And then what happened is that it's become the most beloved and successful part of the city of Athens. And people have really taken it over, and again are very possessive about it. I think that if one day the ministry comes and says, now we're going to dig, I don't think they'll be able to dig, because people, they like it. So it was 1 week of design, 1 week of construction, 3,000 euros, and it made this very kind of nice and active social space. And then finally, sort of to sum it all up, a project that we did in the same area, part of the Athens Biennale, about 4 years ago, is that in one of the other empty plots, this area has a history in the sense that it was a sort of working class neighborhood of two or three story houses. And people would come from the countryside. I think the same thing happens in Kosovo. People come from the countryside to work in the factories and everywhere. And they rent one of these small apartments. And there were beautiful iron stairs that go there in the back of the building, and they bring people onto their apartment. So after these were torn down, we found one of the old iron stairs. We put, again, fantastic graffiti. We put white gravel all over the site, and we took one of these iron stairs and we just stood it up in the middle of the site. And then at the bottom of the stair, so this is a stair, at the bottom of the stair we planted the plant which is called Ipamea indica, which is a plant that grows very quickly if you give it water. So we planted the thing, and we put a big temporary water basin, and we connected it to an irrigation system. And the plants were happy, they were starting to grow. And they were starting to grow, and they were growing. And then there was the opening of the Biennale, and the plants were growing. And everyone was happy, and the plants were growing. And the plants were growing. And then in August, Athenians, if they can, they disappear from Athens. Greeks go on vacation. So we loved the plants and the project, but we had to leave for vacation. So we went to the site, we said goodbye, and we didn't know when we came back at the end of August if the thing would be, would they be alive, would they be dead? So we took some nice pictures and we left. And then we came back at the end of August, so, you know, let's say 4 weeks later, and what we found was this. So what that has done, it has taught us a lesson, and it's given us a way of thinking. And the way of thinking is this, that our responsibility as landscape architects, as designers, as humans, is not to construct something, is not to create a totality, but our responsibility is to make the scaffolding. Our responsibility is to make the very basic structure on which nature, on which life, on which humanity can function and do its own thing. So with that idea, I thank you and I leave you.